one of the most frustrating things about growing up being the son of Yoko is people's misconceptions about her and living with those. And then reading about her as being this kind of dark and angry and destructive force in the Beatles' lives and in my father's life. I would go as far as to say that I think my mom might not have gotten as much flack as she had if she had been, for instance, a blonde woman.
She seemed like this person way out there and famous and living a very different lifestyle from me. I would try to imagine what my mom's life was like. To be really honest, I don't think I had any idea at all.
Yoko Ono became one of the most controversial women of the 20th century by marrying John Lennon. His love for her made her a hate figure, and she's still known as the woman who broke up the Beatles. But Yoko's life before Lennon was just as turbulent. She was a provocative artist, had two broken marriages, and had a daughter who later disappeared. She's the best-known Japanese woman ever, but the real Yoko Ono has always been a mystery.
I was always hidden. Especially when I got together with John, I mean. It was just a situation that I was always put in, where people didn't know me. And I don't think they know me now.
Even from her early days as a performance artist, Yoko liked to shock. In a famous piece in the early 60s, she invited the audience to come up on stage and cut off her clothes.
People were tremendously, you know, rattled by it. And it was a very big thing to, you know, step up there and take the scissors and so forth. And Yoko was astonishing. I mean, so brave, so bold, so cutting edge.
Yoko once told me, if half the audience doesn't get up and leave, she hasn't done it right. Because she wants to really get to people. She wants to really make them feel. But many people have those feelings hidden. And they get angry at Yoko for making them feel like that.
I always felt there was an image. I'm like a fish out of water, and the fish is on the cutting board, and I'm still jumping and trying to breathe, and I'm telling, you know, I'm saying, please just kill me right away so that I can relax a little, you know. You know, why are you still making me jump on the cutting board, you know? And that was the image I had of me while I was doing all these things that would upset everybody, you know.
Yoko's sense of unease had existed since childhood. Born in 1933, she grew up in a Tokyo family of great power and wealth. Her parents, unusually for the time, had married for love. Her father, once a concert pianist, became an international banker. As the family shuttled between Japan and the United States, the swing from east to west became a way of life for Yoko. Several years older than her brother and sister, she usually played alone. Even her mother, a glamorous socialite, had little time for her.
I felt that my mother was a very busy person, though she was very, you know, she was not the kind who would make soup and say, here, drink this, you know, it's not like that. Initially, I wanted to please my mother. Later, I wanted to be a kind of woman that my father approves of. He thought that women had to be intelligent.
Were you a happy child?
Um, This is funny because this 8mm film, me in San Francisco, tap dancing. And, you know, wherever I go, I'm just jumping around. And when you look at that, I think, oh, I was pretty jumpy and probably I was very happy or whatever. But the memory of my childhood is a different thing. I think I was always afraid. Afraid of the dark, afraid of the night coming. Because when I go to sleep, I had a lot of nightmares.
The Onos spent the war years in Japan, but then moved back to America. Yoko didn't feel at home there either.
She was very quiet and retiring and kind of a little kind of wistful and wispy, you know, just kind of floating by, kind of on the edge somewhere.
I was never feeling like I fit in. In the schools in Japan either. Never felt that. Because each time there was a reason that they felt that I was totally different from them.
My strongest visual memory of her is perching in the apple tree, right on the lawn, the great lawn in front of the main building, and she'd be up there writing haiku. And that was sort of her claim to fame. Everyone knew her for that.
In the mid-50s, Yoko dropped out of her smart American college and settled in Lower Manhattan, a world of drafty lofts and beatniks, where at last she found a way to express herself.
Anyone who is interested could come up on the stage and try to fly off from these ladders.
She thought of herself as an artist, and that was the primary thing in her life, and she was involved in, I don't know what she called them, it was possibly happenings or pieces. And you would sit there and watch her throw food at the wall. I think some of it involved cooked peas, so there'd be a great splat. And maybe that was called food piece or peas on the wall. I don't know what it was called exactly. The men were always there, and they were always chasing her, and she was always shoving them off. I don't remember her ever having to pursue anyone. In fact, she went after my men, too, but which somehow didn't bother me. I don't know why. I thought it was funny. She was very funny.
This whole huge object actually may not be here. This whole show may not be here, you know. Or I may not be here, actually.
In 1957, Yoko married Toshi Ichiyanagi, a Japanese composer. 5 years later, she returned with him to Tokyo. While his work was acclaimed, hers was treated with disdain.
I think it must have been really pretty hard indeed, because she was just, you know, on the cusp of achieving a good deal in this little tiny world of avant-garde art. But given the nature of Japanese society, if being a woman artist was tough for us, it was like about 8,000 times tougher for them.
In a society, you want to be yourself, but you know that it's so hard, and they don't want you to be. So if you don't want me like this, you know, why don't you just kill me?
Lonely and depressed, at the age of 29, Yoko tried to take her own life. Her husband and parents put her in a psychiatric hospital. She felt that no one was listening to her. Until one day, a stranger turned up.
There was this one visitor that kept coming every day with flowers or something, and the nurses all fell in love with this guy. You must see this guy. He's so much in love with you. I said, oh, yes, okay, forget it, forget it. I don't want to see anybody, you know.
The visitor was Tony Cox, an American artist who'd admired Yoko's paintings back in New York and had come in search of her. Yoko was seduced and quickly left the hospital with him. Soon she was expecting Tony's child. Divorcing Toshi, she married Tony, and in 1963 gave birth to a girl, Kyoko.
Well, I didn't like Tony, and I thought he was a really poor idea. It was a bit of a mistake. He was, I felt, unimaginative fellow who was really, you know, sort of incorporating himself into what were really her ideas and her performances and things like that.
Their relationship was volatile and within a year had almost broken down. But once they returned to New York, they found success together, with Tony acting as Yoko's promoter. In 1966, when an invitation arrived to an art event in London, Yoko was reluctant to go.
I was in the center of the art world, you know, which is New York. Everything was exciting and happening. And I'm going to go to London. So then I thought, well, okay, I have to not think that provincial. And then I went to London, and bang, it was great. I couldn't believe it.
Yoko decided to stay. Soon, she was making a name for herself, with pieces like Wrapping the Lines in Trafalgar Square. From their flat in the West End, overlooking Regent's Park, she and Tony planned their assault on the London art scene.
She was quiet, and Tony was the one who did all the talking, but she was the power behind, really, and he was the front man. She always knew what she wanted, it seemed, and she always seemed to have things under control. I'm sure she didn't really, but she gave that impression.
It's created by 365 behind, like this. And finally, you get high, you know?
Yoko and Tony's film Bottoms caused another stir. Soon her work caught the eye of the owners of the fashionable Indica Gallery. Here, in November 1966, she staged an exhibition of her work. The Beatles were known to hang out there, and on the night before the official opening, John Lennon dropped by.
I said, today's happening is this, and I just wrote out this card that says, in a tiny letter in the center, breathe, you know? So he went like this, you know, but he came very close to me like this. You know, right here. So I went, yeah, you know, like, yes, you know. So then there was this apple. He just grabbed the apple and he had a bite. And I turned pale. I thought, how dare this guy do this to my work? You know, it doesn't say bite the apple, you know. And I think he got the message from the way I looked. You know, I must have looked incredibly indignant, and I was frozen, like, you know. So he just went like that and just returned the apple in the stand. And I thought, okay, I don't want to know about this guy.
John was still married to Cynthia Lennon. They had a 3-year-old son, Julian. But John's Rolls Royce was soon to be seen driving up to Yoko's London flat.
I think the relationship took off quite quickly after that. And of course, Tony was all in favor because, you know, we all thought this would really promote Yoko's art, which everyone was in favor of.
Soon, she and Lennon were inseparable. But Yoko's newfound happiness would not be welcomed by Beatles fans.
I just thought that it's nice for people to step on a painting and sort of make their natural mark.
No respect for art, then.
Well, you know.
In 1968, Yoko Ono left her husband, Tony, and daughter, Kyoko, to live with John Lennon. He was 27, she was 35.
Hello. How is it?
He was incredibly shy. Now, I know you're not going to believe this, but he was. And that made me feel like we were two of a kind. In terms of what we projected to the society, probably we're both very arrogant and extremely forward, but actually we weren't.
She obviously had a very unhappy life for a long time, and I think the relationship with John was one of the first times in her life where she really felt at one with herself.
Nobody ever loved me like she does.
Yoko encouraged Lennon to experiment with avant-garde art. He publicly declared his love for Yoko by dedicating his first exhibition to her.
And if somebody loved me like she do me, who she do me? Yes, she does.
The actual opening night, he had a huge amount of white balloons, 365 balloons, and they went up very, very slowly up above the rooftops in Mayfair, and John and Yoko looked up, and the whole crowd outside and the press, and there was a very quiet, a very sort of lull in everything as the balloons floated away.
I'm in love for the first time.
But back in the studio, John's obsession with Yoko was beginning to upset the other Beatles. Tensions amongst the band had been obvious for some time, and Yoko's musical suggestions didn't help.
They felt tremendously intimidated by this, all of them, not just Paul or whatever. It was all four of them, particularly Ringo, actually, really felt that she had broken the magic, that the intimacy was gone, that the four-way bonding that these guys had, because they'd been together for so long and gone through so much together, was just being completely intruded upon and ripped apart by Yoko's suggestions and comments.
Everybody seemed to be paranoid except for us two, who were in the glow of love, and everybody sort of was tense around us, and, you know, what is she doing here at the session, or why is she with him, and all this sort of madness is going on around us because we want to be together all the time.
People were really angry, very angry about it, and thought that Yoko was, you know, the devil incarnate. Whereas actually, she was just John's girlfriend, and it was all John's fault, in the sense that he was the one who said she had to sit next to him on the piano stool. He was the one who insisted that she even came with him to the bathroom in Abbey Road. I mean, she could have said no, of course, but she didn't.
When I first got into the situation, I had no idea about anything. I didn't have any idea about it, about how people felt about the Beatles and what it meant to them and what it would mean for John to get together with me. And in fact, I was talked about like the biggest homebreaker in the world or something like that. But of course, they don't realize the other side of it, that John might have broken my home too, Tony, Kyoko, and I.
Yoko married John in the spring of 1969. Using their private life to promote peace and love, she and John took to their bed in a Yoko-style happening.
John and Yoko getting together at that point pretty much saved John's life, because he was really in grave danger of becoming an acid casualty, of really burning his brain out, just really frying himself. What happened when John and Yoko got together was that they got strung out on smack almost immediately, and this got him over his LSD period.
The couple set up their marital home in a mansion outside Ascot, Tittenhouse Park. By April 1970, the acrimony amongst the Beatles had reached a head. The band broke up, and Yoko and John withdrew from the world, rarely seeing anyone but each other.
It was almost like the bed in reverse, that they were staying in bed day after day, week after week. You know, the relationship, I think, had become rather smothering for them. It was getting almost too intense. Certainly, there were some drugs involved as well at that time, which didn't help. They were living very much in a cocoon in their own world.
Ah, we'll make it jolly.
Yes, you know, we have to make it jolly.
We can't all afford to be neurotic.
Maybe we might stop the war.
By being jolly?
Yes, because the thing is, have you ever seen a person killing somebody with a smile on his face and being happy? No. Killers are unhappy people. And they're violent because they're so unhappy and so damn serious.
Mrs. Lennon, we're boring each other, so I'll go away.
See you about that? I mean...
Thank you. Goodbye.
I was fiercely independent kind of person. I didn't like the idea of getting married to anybody. And if I were to be married, I like the idea that I'm the one who's the earner. Well, you know, control freak, you can say control freak, you know. But basically, I just didn't want any of it, really.
To add to Yoko's anxieties, her daughter's father, Tony Cox, was beginning to wonder whether the Lennons' world was the right place for the 8-year-old Kyoko.
When I was a kid with my mom and John, this is when they first got together. It was a drag. Everywhere you went, people were, you know, screaming. I remember as a kid having to lie down in the back of cars and having to, like, when I came out of my dance lessons, having to go out the back door with dumpster and the garbage in the alley was stupid things like that, you know?
In 1971, Tony took Kyoko into hiding. The Lennons tracked them down to Mallorca, where they were staying with the Beatles' former guru, the Maharishi. Yoko was determined to get her daughter back.
Oh, well, we tried to kidnap her. Which was a totally wrong thing to do, of course. And she started screaming.
The Lennons were taken to court for attempted abduction. A custody battle ensued. The judge asked Kyoko which of her parents she wanted to live with. She chose Tony.
I was not mean to her or abusive to her. But ignoring might be considered abusive in a way, you know, of course. Or getting married to somebody else might be considered abusive.
Within months, Tony and Kyoko disappeared again. Yoko began a new search, but she wouldn't see her daughter for 25 years.
The thing is, I felt that Kyoko probably would find out later or maybe then that I was looking for her. And that should be a kind of, some kind of satisfaction to her that actually I cared.
And I don't want to do anything to harm her or hurt her. I don't want to cause any panic.
So not for some, like, somebody to come, you know, bring out the child or something. We don't want any of that jazz. We'd like to just somebody find where she is and then we'll do the rest.
We did the Ouija board to try and find clues because nobody could find a trace of Tony and Kyoko. So Yoko tried other methods, spiritual ways, to try and get a clue of where they could possibly be.
In her search for her daughter, Yoko discovered a new source of power. The occult became a vital part of her life for the next decade. It made people even more suspicious of her.
John was fascinated by her. Most people, even those who couldn't stand her, were fascinated and mystified by her. And she could call upon a certain type of intuition, a certain kind of, I'm going to use the phrase, people always get uptight about this stuff, but a certain kind of mystical knowledge, as if she was tapping into certain sources of information beyond the kind of stuff that we do.
I didn't really know who she was, even though she told me her name. And I know it sounds crazy, but it's like When she said, John, I said to her something about, I get a man in your life, I get initial J, and she said, that's my husband, John, and she kept looking at me like I was a little nuts. Even when she said John Lennon, I had to think who she's talking about. But at the end, something happened, something triggered off in me, and I looked at her and I said, wait a minute, you know, I don't think your husband has a happy ending. And she said, what do you mean? And I'll never forget, and I could see like a man's chest, and said, it's like he sleeps in blood. That's what I told her.
In late 1971, Yoko and John moved to New York, where their radical politics alarmed the Nixon administration. There too, Yoko was obscured by her husband's charisma.
People were always trying to like elbow Yoko aside so they could talk to John. It really hurt her career because it brought all this attention to her career, to her artwork that of a lot of people who didn't understand it, and a lot of people who made fun of it and ridiculed it, where she had been quite a star in the avant-garde world. People think that it was the greatest thing just to be famous, but to be famous when everybody's calling you names because they don't like what you do is not a good thing.
Soon, Yoko's relationship with John was under pressure, and to make matters worse, the FBI was looking for a way to deport them. At a party on the night of Nixon's re-election, Yoko took the fallout from John's fury.
I remember driving in the car, and John was spewing curses and screaming like a Liverpool sailor. I mean, there were expressions I had never heard before. And we got to the party, there was only a few people left, and John was really raging, and ended up in a room, and some girl started caressing him or whatever.
And then suddenly they started to make love, and we can all hear it. And I was just frozen, stuck there, sitting. And all that time, this woman was saying, you don't understand how we feel about John, do you? I mean, he's the most lovely, the most beautiful person, and we all love him. You know, to me. And I'm saying, yes, you know, thank you. You know, like, I didn't know what to say.
It's just this awkward silence with just occasional sounds coming from the room where John was. It was a very depressing thing to be at a party when your lover is making out with somebody in another room. But I don't know. I mean, there's different ways to react. I guess she was just very sad and depressed and just sort of sitting there waiting for it to be over, whereas I suppose other people would have interrupted and started screaming and throwing dishes or something. She's not like that.
The Lennons moved into the Dakota, a Gothic apartment block overlooking Central Park. By August 1973, Yoko realized her relationship with John had reached crisis point. She came up with a plan to test their love and approached their assistant with an extraordinary suggestion.
I wanted to be with somebody who was totally in love with me, who was passionate, and who wanted to really make love to me. Period. I thought I deserved that, you know. Well, maybe that's not very realistic, you know, that can't always have that, I don't know. And I thought John deserved it too.
Yoko walked into the room, and I thought, oh my God, she's up too early for me. I'm not ready for her. And she said, you know, John and I are not getting along. And I went into this glaze, and I thought, I'm sorry to hear that. And it was just running through my head, and then I heard her say, well, you know, I know you don't have a boyfriend. And it just sort of snapped me back into reality, and I said, excuse me? What does that have to do with anything? And she says, well, you know, I thought that you should go out with John. And I thought to myself, but I'm not interested in your husband. And she said, oh, I know that you're not interested, but it's okay.
May Pang was ideal for this mission. To the best of my recollection, May was not a drinker, and she didn't use any narcotics or anything like that. She seemed to be a very responsible person and a fairly level-headed woman.
Within weeks, John and May had flown to Los Angeles. There, despite May's initial hesitation, they began an affair.
Nobody could have made John fall in love with me if he himself didn't want to. And that, he always said, he wouldn't just go out with somebody just because someone else told him. He had to have had that feeling as well. So he reassured me all the time about that.
I was sleeping alone and my body was shaking, and it was incredible. I mean, you know, like shaking because I'm alone. And this went on about 2 weeks, I think. But I didn't tell John about this, because then John would just come back like that, and I didn't want that. You know, we should be together because we love each other and we respect each other, not because we need, you know, a pillow or something, you know. So I thought, I have to get over this. And the thing is, it was almost like a withdrawal. It's a withdrawal. It's a withdrawal from intimacy.
But throughout the long months of their separation, Yoko and John telephoned each other several times a day.
He was preoccupied with how to get back to Yoko. That was the thing that he repeatedly said to me and frequently said to Yoko. He said, I'm ready now to come home. And Yoko said, no, you're not. You're not ready yet. And perhaps she wasn't ready yet to receive him.
Yoko began to emerge from John's shadow. After a year apart, she traveled to Japan for her first solo tour.
It happened at the time of my life, when I least expected.
Why did you eventually decide that you wanted him back?
Because I realized that I really loved John. And it was a very strange thing. It's always that the kind of weakness in man that I tune into, it seems like. When they're very strong, I think, get out of here. You know, it's like, I don't want to know, you know? But when I went to Elton John's concert, where John was on stage and everybody was applauding like crazy, and the whole concert hall was shaking because of that. I mean, it was incredible, you know? But he looked like a very lonely figure, and he was just kind of bowing once too often. I thought, this is not the John I know, you know? Is this John? I mean, I was feeling so bad, and I was crying like crazy. And we just went to backstage, and John was sitting there. And he looked at me, and I looked at him, and I was smiling, just kind of smiling politely or whatever you call it. But it kind of, we understood each other.
And I knew right there that something was up. And we walked along, and he said, listen, Yoko's allowed me to come home. And I just sort of looked at him and said, allowed? He goes, yeah. I was very sad. I remember calling her up and saying to her, talking to her on the phone, I said, well, congratulations, you have John back now. And I hope you're happy. And I meant it. And she said to me, well, I don't know if I'll ever be happy. But neither here nor there. And she just said, I must go. And that was it.
Within days of John's return to the Dakota, at the age of 42, Yoko had conceived their child. Her gamble had paid off. After John Lennon returned to Yoko Ono, she gave birth to their son in October 1975. They gave up public life. John stayed at home to take care of Sean, while Yoko discovered a new passion, the business of the booming Lennon empire.
If I sang in a song.
Sang out of tune.
Before you cross the street. busy making other plans.
Sean was four when his parents emerged from their reclusive lifestyle and began writing music together. The launch of their album, Double Fantasy, put them center stage once more.
I felt that, or John and I felt that we were doing everything right in a way. Arrogance, maybe. But we felt that finally we were doing things right. It was a time when we were very exposed because of Double Fantasy. And it was very strange because I kept having this kind of flash of John being kidnapped. And I said, just please be careful, you know, because things like that could happen too, you know. So naturally, we felt a little bit scared.
Goodbye, 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 my love. It's time to say goodbye.
The shooting happened just after Lennon and his wife Yoko stepped from a chauffeured car after returning from a recording session. The killer shouted his name, then fired five shots at close range. Cradled in the arms of his wife Yoko...
It's important that people remember that Yoko was there. Yoko heard the gunshots, saw her husband fall, saw the glass of the door shatter and splatter, saw the blood, heard the siren, and saw her partner and her lover fall to the ground.
When I was in the hospital, I was at the hospital, and the doctor came and said, now you have to tell the people, because I think the radio show and press, and they were all wanting to know. And you have to tell, you know, could we announce it? I said, please wait. Why wait? But I felt like by announcing it, it really becomes the truth, you know? And I just wanted a little while longer for John to be around, you know.
Yoko did tell the world of her husband's death, but it took another 24 hours for her to break the news to their son.
I just didn't have the heart to face Sean and say, Sean, what are you going to say, Sean? What? Finally, I said to Sean's nanny, please tell him to come to my room.
I have a memory of walking into the bedroom at the Dakota. My mom's sitting in bed. Sitting up in bed. I remember seeing like a newspaper to her left, which somehow in my mind is a headline about my father being killed. I remember my mom saying, your father's dead.
And Sean said, oh, mommy, but you know, you're still attractive and beautiful, so you'll get somebody else, don't worry. And I'm saying, oh, that's what it meant to him, okay. You know, I'm relieved, you know. And then I found out that he went back to his room and he was crying. And, you know, they told me that, crying. But he didn't want to show tears to me. He just wanted to tell me that I'll be all right, you know.
You're a beautiful boy with all your little toys. Your eyes have seen the world.
In the days and weeks that I spent with her, she rarely spoke, hardly ate. She was inconsolable. It was just, It was the darkest of times.
It's like you ask somebody who was in a plane accident and she survived and everybody else died or something, and how did she manage to come out or something? I mean, I don't think she knows. I think she just does it, you know? And that's how I was. I just tried to, I feel like I was in a deep water. And I just wanted to get to the top to breathe.
I remember my relationship with my mom kind of beginning on some level, or my real relationship with her beginning at that point. And we became a lot closer, obviously. And I felt in some way like I was, you know, being introduced to her for the first time at that moment, because she had kind of played a secondary role until then. It was kind of like a tornado when my dad died. And so we really kind of held on to each other and became very close.
My mom here, I've been asking her since I was about 3, I think, if I could come here, and she'd always say, you'll go in a couple of months and stuff like that. So I'd say, okay, in a couple of months, and I've never went, and this is the first time I've been here, and I feel great.
Yoko started to rebuild her life, beginning a new relationship with Sam Havatoy, her antiques dealer, whom she still lives with today.
It's amazing that I came out of it. But now I feel that with all that experience, that I'm gonna start a new life. That's how I feel about it. And I don't know how it's gonna be, but probably that's how it's gonna be. Did I make myself clear?
Yoko's life still wasn't easy. In public, many people continued to show her hostility.
Well, I'm sure that there are many people who are scared of me or suspicious of me or whatever. Well, I feel sorry for them. You know, I feel like saying, well, don't worry, you don't have to be scared.
Now, who's gonna be doing that?
In particular, some of John Lennon's family have criticized the way she has handled his legacy.
I was mostly upset by the fact that I didn't receive any of his actual belongings as far as guitars and pianos, and I think she's probably one of the most insecure women I've ever met in my life, you know. But she plays it from a very, she tries to play it from a very powerful role, you know, power role.
Do you understand at all why he could have been so critical?
Oh, Julian.
Julian.
Well, I think that he's a very pained person now, and he's going through his pain. And I hope one day he's going to come through that and maybe become a happier person. But he's expressing his pain in the way he wants to. And it's to do with his pain more than to do with maybe me, I don't know.
When people badmouth my mom in general in the press, whether it's, you know, a critic or just a reporter, or, you know, especially if it's Julian or something, she really, really gets hurt by it.
By 1993, Yoko's daughter, Kyoko, was considering whether to get back in touch. Her father, Tony Cox, had taken her into hiding after a bitter custody battle 22 years earlier. She was about to get married.
When I became engaged, I told my husband that before I have children, I will want to contact my mother. I just don't feel it's right for me to become a mother without at least letting my mother know that I'm alive and well. How could I stand loneliness, loneliness? And so I called her up and, of course, got like an assistant or someone like that. And I was very nervous. And I just said, I would like to speak with Yoko Ono, please. I'm a relative of hers. And he goes, well, what's your name? And I said, well, I'm not going to say. And he said, well, come on, you should at least tell me your name. So I said, I'll just give you a phone number. If she wants, she can call me back. And he said, okay. So just a few minutes later, my mother called. And it was like, wow, you know.
Has it been difficult getting to know her again?
No, I mean, she's a very intelligent, very quick and sensitive soul, and very independent too. And we get along very well as friends.
In the last few years, Yoko has returned to her art, something she's relied on throughout her life.
She never allows anything in her life to interfere with her being a creative person. I really feel for her, creativity is the number one most important thing. Above all, above her relationships, above her, above me. If we're driving, you know, to a movie theater in a taxi, she'll be like, get me a piece of paper, you know? And she'll like write something down, and you know, a couple of days later, it'll either be like some art piece or a painting or a song or something, and she's just incredibly creative.
Is she happy?
No. She doesn't laugh as loud or as often. I think she has less to look forward to. You know, I spoke to her on the phone a few days ago, and, you know, she's given me this list of things that she's doing and, you know, experiences. They're all genre-related, they're art-related, et cetera. Sometimes I wonder if she ever considers what life would be like without doing all of that. That would be the real loneliness. All the things that she continues to do keeps her connected to the only one she ever loved, which was John Lennon.
It's not something you ever get over. I think it's something that eventually you might get used to. You know, when you get cut really deeply, the wound will heal, but there'll always be a scar. And this is a wound that's easily opened.
I think that there were many magical things that happened in my life. And people want to deny each one of them for some reason. Yes, those things did happen, and not all of them were beautiful or nice, but the beautiful things did happen too.